So we'll get going at 7:18 or so. I will apologize in advance to everybody. I came in on the red eye this morning, so I'm kind of going on fumes at the moment. So we'll do what we can. Adjustments to the agenda. I have two. I want to add a 6.3 for staff appreciation and 6.4 to talk very briefly about the PEC estate. PEC. 3.0, audience and communications.
A couple other adjustments?
Oh, yeah.
There's no 6.1.2. That policy has been pulled back for now.
So the revised agenda that Sandy sent is further revised then?
Right, you have, so the lineup shows 6.1.2, the search and seizure.
Okay, yep.
That's taken off, and then 8.6 is the hiring authority for some, through the chair.
Yep.
Okay.
That's on there, yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Okay, any others? Anyone?
We have executive session scheduled, right?
Yes.
I think we do.
Yes, we do.
Okay, because we gotta.
That would be nice.
We have business to conduct there. So.
All right. So, audience communications. Kate, you got anything?
Nope.
All right. Thank you. 4.0 then. Presentations.
Okay. So, we would like to introduce to you our amazing, incredible art teachers, Katie O'Brien and Sonic Samet. Between the two of them, they have created many wonderful installations for our school and a continual changing art display in all of our hallways. And they want to share with you their program and some artworks of all the great things they do.
Okay, so to start off, I'm going to just hand this out to you. Our art program is based on this. At the beginning of each school year, we poll the teachers and find out what they're teaching for themes on a monthly basis. And this chart is what we put together based on what the information they give us. All the highlighted areas are where we're able to integrate with them, and we do integrate with them throughout the course of the year. So we're just going to show you some of the projects and explain how we integrate and connect with the National Arts Standards.
All right. So I teach K-2, but we've been spending a lot of time talking about the standards in all of our in-services and in meetings together. So it's something we're thinking about all the time. Basically, the basic elements of art are what we work with, and those standards sort of group inside of that. And the standards are set up, the National Art Standards are set up with four anchor standards: the creating, presenting, responding, and connecting. And we use all of those in most of our projects. And we have been kind of all through. Now, what we do in terms of age levels is that we start with basic skills in those elements of art. So when we talk about elements of art, we're talking line, form, color, shape, space, texture, and value. So we start, I teach K-2, and I teach K-5 in another school, but the way I run my part of the program is to start developing those skills on a very low, very simple level with small children. How do you hold a paintbrush? How do you use paint without making a muddy mess? You know, how do you trace something? How do you cut something? And from there, we just keep building. Every year, we introduce those same, we kind of revisit those skills, and then we build on those skills based on different materials, adding different dimensions to projects. So they get the same things, but they get it a little more advanced every year. So we build on those skills so that when they leave us to go on to middle school, they're equipped with what they need, and it's developmentally right, you know, in terms of their creative development. We want them to be right on target when they go to fifth grade, knowing what they need to know, you know, through middle school, and then when they leave middle school, they go into high school. We want them to have a good foundation. So one of the, an easiest way to kind of explain that to you is to show you like one skill that we work on and then demonstrate how we touch on that through several different levels. So I kind of went with color theory. And when we start with color theory with kindergarten, it's all about, along with the basic skills of learning how to paint, it's about creating and learning how to mix color. So we start with these color wheel birds where they actually mix on a string, on a strip of paper, the elementary or the primary and secondary colors, and then they might trace the bird and cut it out, and then they build the collage, and then we embellish. You have to embellish everything, you know, glitter, feathers, sequins. It's all about that. So that's like the first thing. And then color mixing is always in there. So whenever I do a project that involves paint, using construct or any kind of painted paper, we paint our own paper. So we call it community paper. And so we will have kids make a green frog by first creating green paper using blue and yellow. And they'll create two, a dark green and a light green, which brings in a tint and a shade. And then we cut it up and bring it to something else by turning it into a frog or pumpkins or something like that. So that's how we build on color theory. The next level might be second or third grade, when they start, hot and cool color collages. And we are not collages, weavings. So this is an example of a warm color weaving. And this is printed, again, painted paper. And then we weave into it. The suns are, these are also warm and cool projects. So again, you know, that we focus on color mixing and pairing colors together or mixing them up or kind of developing that. But all the time you're working on these other skills, you know, line, form, shape, color, texture, how to add texture. Kindergarten, this is every year we seem to start off with a project that really uses so many of the values and the elements of art. These are both kindergarten projects, and we start by doing rubbings. And so we do rubbings with crayon, lots and lots of rubbings, rubbing all kinds of stuff that will give a texture. And then we use a resist method because it's wax. We add water and watercolor, and that resists the paint, the water. So then we have a resist painting method that they then paint these with. We sort of reference Vincent van Gogh. It's sunflower, so we bring kind of him into the mix. And then in this one project, this is printing. We print leaves by just rolling, you know, rollers over them and printing them. And then they have to cut and assemble. So the project takes several classes, and quite often they have no clue what they're doing and what they, you know, they know they're working on this, they're working on that, but there's no product until the end. It's pretty much all process until we get to that part. So that is, and then as we go up through, when we get to middle school, we want to go to these. So then third and fourth grade, we do a lot of Eric Carle. He's wonderful for painted paper, color mixing. Again, we make the papers and then we assemble with the papers that we made. Fifth grade, cactus?
That's fifth grade.
Fifth grade, we do Katie. These are Katie's project. I've never done this one, but Katie does this. It's always a real success. They do more color work. And then always bringing an artist whenever we can. This is a fauve painting where they start to learn about analogous colors. So as we begin moving up the color wheel, we start getting away from secondary, primary, tertiary, and move into analogous colors, tints and shades. Complementary colors and all those things. So that's kind of an example. Then as we get into sixth and seventh grade, it becomes more sort of cultural work. And Katie does a mate painting. And is that in here? So this is Mexican mate painting. both of these are. And for 7th and 8th, we begin to really dig into artists and different art styles and bringing in surrealism, impressionism. Katie does a project, I don't see 7, 8 anymore, but Katie does a project that's always really successful where they study each, pick an artist's style, and then they duplicate one picture in that artist's style all through it, like in 6 different segments or something like that, right?
Yeah, I actually introduced 10 different artists, all different styles, and the kids come up with their own image, which might be a pumpkin. And then they've got to, through what they learned, they would have to do a very small piece like Van Gogh and like Kathy Cole with, so they can see somebody who does something all in just black and very disturbing colors, or do they do just polka dots, or is it Keith Haring? But it's amazing how much they learn and how much they pick up on that.
So these are 7, 8, right? This is Romare Bearden.
Yeah.
Collage and color study. This brings in a whole bunch of things. And this was the Fauve?
These are the Fauve artists
where they create something in colors you wouldn't normally see them, like the Fauve artists did. So that's kind of the way we bring them up through color. So when they leave middle school, they are well aware of color wheels, all of the colors on the color wheel, how to use color, how to tint and shade color, how to mix color, which is right where they should be. So
So I just have a few other projects I'd like to show you that the middle schoolers do. When we work with line, we do Zentangle type designs, which they absolutely love that. And it's amazing how they can just pick right up on that.
Doodling would take on a life of its own. I mean, really, it's doodling, right?
And then we work with the concept of positive and negative and do stamp carving, which then they do prints of. But then they also have to print it onto fabric, and then they also have to do some sewing to turn it into a pillow. And my favorite is recycle art, which these are actually soda cans that they turn into little creatures.
They love this.
Yeah.
This project is always a hit.
So once they reach middle school, I really do try to just saturate them with all the different types of mediums so that they can make decisions about what they like and which direction they choose to go in, because I find that a lot of our kids, once they get to CVU, a lot of them get that intro art class, and then they are so busy they don't ever get to move on from that. Another recycle project, this was altered books, where they had to create something totally out of a book. So this.
Yeah, it's a great book recycling project, another one they really love.
And for the little kids, a lot of the assessment is just verbal. You just have the kids look at their artwork all together, decide who used the most warm colors, cold colors, which one was the happiest. But for middle school, a lot of times we just do assessment sheets, because trying to get them to all finish something at the same time just doesn't ever happen. So if they can fill out their own assessment sheet, that's really great. And then there's always a filler project that they move on to. But
And in terms of assessment, Katie's right. On the elementary level, we are constantly assessing what they're doing. As you probably all know, you can't talk at kindergarten or first grade very long. You got to keep them busy. So I'm assessing while they work, and we will stop working sometimes, clean up early and do a museum walk, where we walk around and observe what we've done, and then we sit down and we talk about what they noticed, what their observations are. And so a lot of things happen very spontaneously in terms of assessment. A lot of things happen for me in how did you feel while you were doing this, when we still life draw. I do that in another school more than this one because of our setup is a little different. But, you know, how did you feel when you were doing that? How, you know, what did you notice? And so a lot of that happens on the go all the time. So art shows?
Yeah.
Okay, so we do a number of shows. Where's your sheet, Kate? Right here. I'm going to talk about the fabric.
Yeah.
We were donated, Katie has a lot of connections. She's very connected. And was given fabric from Burton. And they have boxes of this incredible fabric that they had. And their only request was that you try and make something and maybe contribute it to the art hub. And I don't know if we have a picture of that or not.
You've all been in the office.
You've seen it. There's a giant bicycle wheel of flowers that she made with fabric that are just outstanding. That actually went to the art hub. So
it was actually kids that made it.
Yeah, no, well, I mean, you put it together, right. It's the royal we.
She did.
The CVU district show you participated in this year, because I'm not middle school, I wasn't involved in that at all. The Champlain Regional University Mall show, which is also a middle school.
It's 5'8".
5'8" show. So that's, you know, she hangs and takes down that show. The Carpenter Cars Library show is K-5, and we do that together, which is always a really nice event. Kids really are excited about having their work shown. And I just have to say, you know, we aren't even talking yet about these incredible installations that Katie, let's be clear on this, Katie does this. Katie goes home with a saw, and I mean, I just, every now and then she'll say, would you? And I'm like, absolutely. But it is really her thing, these installations. But I have to say about when we make art, we hang a lot of art. And I think part of the reason for that is we hang it and that conversation continues. When a child sees work or kids see work that other kids have done, it continues the conversation around the art. Kids get to tell other kids what they did, how they did it. And then the other kids look forward to, are we going to do that next year when we get there? So there's a real conversation, and then it goes home on the best frame there is on the refrigerator at home. But it really does. So we change art up a lot. When I first came to Hinesburg, I was blown away by the amount of work in the halls all the time. But it's just... great. People love it. We love it. And it gives a really dynamic environment. So now you talk about those installations.
Okay. So the last piece of our program, obviously, is all the art grants we've been getting, which this year we had sixth graders produce two murals for the school, which are amazing. Fifth graders did an assemblage piece, which basically is a painted piece, but you also assemble on top of it. So this was the last one done. The K-1s did an Alexander Calder-inspired bottle cap and straw piece for the flex space, which you've probably all seen. And we're currently working on Eric Carl animals for the front of the school that the kids are slowly but surely working on painting. And then I also have one middle school student who is working on her own piece that she just has to work on. And she comes in 2 times a week during my planning times, and then I stay an hour and a half on Mondays with her. And she is coming up with this painting, which she wants to donate to the middle school, to Sterling. So, and there will be more next year. So that's pretty much it. Sure.
You were talking a lot, Sunny, about the K-2s and especially kindergarten being very process-driven. Do the kids
have some sort of vision of where they're driving towards at the beginning of the process, or is it just sort of, well, we're going to go step by step and work our way through, and then they're excited at the end when they get to where they...
Not all their products.
Or do you show them like a completed piece?
No. Not always, but a lot of the times we do. And this particular one, we don't. Because sometimes that changes their thought process. And so we want them to do the process without sort of being worried about where it's going to end up. But most of the time, I'd say most of the projects, we start with a sample that we show them, unless it would be prohibitive to do that. The worst thing you can do is, you know, draw something and leave it up. We should probably turn it over so that they do their own work.
Right.
'Cause, you know, they're very apt to try and copy what you did.
It's supposed to look like that.
Yeah. Yeah. And so we a lot of times they really do have a vision. But when we paint paper, you know, community paper, we just talk about creating paper is a community for the art room, you know, to use together to create projects. Right now we're the first graders are making, using old CDs to create flowers like Mother's, we call it Family Day or Mother's Day. And they use, you know, cut paper petals and glue them to the CDs, and then we put a stick and it makes this wonderful giant painted paper flower that they love. They love doing that stuff. So that's where our community paper comes in. So yes, to answer to your thing, we only do that when it seems like it makes more sense not to show them. But most things, they start out with a sample.
So it's amazing the work that the two of you do in the building. Always looks fabulous. So thank you so
much
for that. It's just incredible. And what you're able to get out of the students. And I'm just kind of interested in the assessment piece and how they self-assess. Because I'm not really an accomplished artist myself, I understand that I can look at art and look for different characteristics based on prior training, but I'm really interested in how your students learn to critique themselves or others and how that informs.
Well, they're really hard on themselves. They really are. So, like for my kids, it's like I'm walking around constantly and like pointing out things. Like if it's a specific artist and they have a certain style, it's like, well, do you have like those details that we talked about? Or like with the masks, they either were told to either build out something on it, not just leave it flat, or do something amazing with like things that they could add to it. So if they've achieved either of those, to change it, rather than just painting it red and throwing glitter on it and saying, there, I'm done. Mm-hmm. I rarely have kids who do that because they're so into it. And the Hinesburg kids are amazing anyway. It's like you can talk them into anything. It's like you bring in a bunch of water bottles and say, we're gonna like turn this into a chandelier, we're gonna paint it and do something. And they're like, yeah, okay, you know, so you've always got them. They're always willing to try stuff, so.
But I think they see the success of
the other projects in the halls, like you talked about. They see their imagination is sparked by what you're already doing, turning, you know, making a beautiful mural out of ball caps.
They don't.
So they believe you because they see it.
and they don't hurt anything. It's like, you know, Allegra keeps saying, oh, is that assemblage piece still up there? It's like, because, you know, the cows are made out of champagne corks,
right,
and they're sticking out. And it's like
3D. You can't tell that.
Yeah,
picture,
it's like,
it's
nobody's pulled anything off.
No, the kids love it. They talk about it all the time.
They do, but and I think they release one another.
Right.
So.
Well, they kind of do, you know, and we hang everything. We don't hang just the best pieces. We hang everybody's work. So I think there's a kind of a blanket sort of knowledge that unless you say, I do not want my work hung up, which is absolutely okay. If somebody says to me, I don't want it hung up, they don't get it hung up. That's certainly a privilege. But most of them, you know it's going to get hung because we don't just pick out the best stuff. We hang by class or by grouping. And I think there's something in that. They know that it's all going to be out there. And the connections that get made, I have to tell them about Broderick. We have this wonderful, I have a first grader, Broderick, who's a precocious little fella, and he saw the painted Indian elephant mural. We have a mural that Katie did with the kids and is up. And he got very curious about that and wanted to know if they still have those houses that go on elephants. And he badgered his teacher so much, he sent him to the library. And the library couldn't find anything, and they sent him to us. Or he came to me, and we got online, and we started looking. And then he decided he was going to make a painted elephant. And he did some, and then he brought it to Katie. And, you know, and then Katie gave him some more stuff to work on, and he took that home. I mean, the connection, the ripple effect of the connections that they see, lots of times will get them excited to move to a different thing and to be ready for the next thing that comes up. Assessment is a hard thing in art.
Mm-hmm.
If you ask me to grade art, I'm always going to grade up, because what would we do if we were telling kids that their art wasn't any good? And I think it's really important to have an understanding of creative development. more than to grade art, we need to be aware of creative development. And when kids are kindergarten and first grade, they're very into manipulating art and seeing what they can do. What will this do when I do something with it? What can I make it do? And in second and third grade, they start to get into symbolism. You know, the symbols, we all see it, the lollipop trees, the sun, you know, everything has a symbol. And in fourth and fifth grade, they no longer really want, they're not happy with those symbols anymore. So the challenge there is to provide them with experiences that will allow them to grow wherever they are without asking them to draw. And your drawing can be very intimidating. But lots of times, if we can get them through that stage, then they get into sixth grade when their skill development is a little better, their manual skill development is better, and then they can learn those pieces which keep them engaged and hooked into the arts. Mm-hmm. So I think the creative development piece is more important than sort of the assessment piece, in a way. We have to assess them. It's part of what we do. But you'd have to work really hard to get a zero in art. I mean, you'd be, have to really be trying or not doing anything. And there's been kids that don't, you know, in middle school especially, who tune out and don't do anything. But for the most part, all this recycled stuff and mask and 3D work, they're just itching to get at it. So it's a good thing. That was kind of long-winded. Sorry.
No, I mean, I love that Aristotle is known to have said, art is where one practices choice.
Right.
And, you know, in the early grades, if we can allow kids to practice choice, and there's really no extreme right or extreme wrong.
Right.
It's just choices.
Making choices is a huge part of making art.
And
yeah.
It just seems to me that you really do a lot of that with your kids.
Keith, can I make a comment? So I think sometimes we don't thank our teachers enough. And both of you, I couldn't do an unbelievably good job. And I ran to Mrs. O'Brien one time downtown, and she said to me, yeah, sometimes I drive Tim, Tim's the facilities guy, I drive Tim crazy because, you know, he I ask him, what do I do this or that? You know, I really, really appreciate that. And the comment I get from people who walk through the school who don't go through the school is always the artwork. They are just amazed, and people mm-hmm. stand in the hallways. When I walk through with my kids, I have two seventh graders and a second grader, so it's a big span now. Even in seventh grade, they want me to stop and see their piece on the wall. And I really, really appreciate that. The other thing I would say to you is you're doing something right, because all my kids, and Addie's in second grade now, but up until fourth grade, and I said to them, what do you think you want to be when you grow up? One of the first things they said was an artist. And I know that's coming from the good job you folks do, encouraging them, inspiring them. I still have Van Gogh, is it Van Gogh sunflowers?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, me too.
They're still on the wall in my kitchen.
See,
in frames.
You for sure are.
So I think sometimes, well, maybe look at myself, you know, I view the instructors with sometimes a critical eye because my expectations of you are so high. And I couldn't applaud you enough, so thank you very much.
Well,
thank you.
Thanks.
I echo what he said completely.
Well, it's a blast. It really is.
It really is. And you know, if it's not fun, if they're not happy, if they're not excited, if we're not having a good time and enjoying what we're doing, then it wouldn't be that way. Kids have to be. If they're not happy in art, we're doing something wrong. They should be happy.
Well, let me just add to that. I'll just brief. And I applaud the administrators because my second grader is so happy to have art 2 days a week.
Oh.
So thank you for that.
Yeah, me too. Well, that put me on a second day a week, and I just love the young children. That's my love. And I love being there at the beginning when they first open that box up of creativity and being the one who, you know, just in the early ages, I just love it. It's terrific.
I just want to say one thing, and we'll probably stop talking. I appreciate that you shared this. I'm assuming this means that you tie in to the classroom what the kids are learning in their areas, in their classes, which I think is great. Do you ever have My daughter really appreciates, she does this after school art thing on Friday with, I can't remember her name.
Chris,
yes. And she loves it. It's one of her favorite things because it's just kind of like a art makerspace, I guess.
Yeah.
And so I guess, do the kids ever get that kind of opportunity in your classroom, or is it not really, doesn't really work that way?
You know, that's a project. It's like, I kind of hold back on that. Like, third and fourth graders are going to be inventing, so I bring out all my junk.
Yeah.
But
they love that.
And they do love that.
What do they call that? Recycle.
They do inventions, but then they've got to present them before the class and explain how they work and stuff. So, yeah, they will.
Yeah.
But I can't do what Chris does because she just has so much.
Well, when you're not held by curriculums and standards and, you know,
and time.
The time is the hardest. We only have enough time to do a very brief introduction, a little bit of demonstration, and then they're on. And it's 25 minutes of work, and you're cleaning it up. So it happens pretty fast.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sure. Sure. Our pleasure.
Those artifacts. It was great to see the color.
I know. Slides just don't do it.
Great.
So was that Mask of Day of the Dead or
Mask of
Her take on it. It's the same girl who's doing the mural.
Oh.
But yeah, she kind of likes the darker things.
Yeah.
But it's appropriate for her.
Yeah, well,
age.
You know, look at the guy who did Dungeons and Dragons.
She babysits for us, and she's been showing my daughter, Charlotte, the Zentangle, or whatever it's called.
Yeah.
So I learned about that through them.
Yeah, she's awesome.
She's really,
she really
good.
Is.
She's so creative.
But she won't go for art. She wants to be an author.
Thanks so much.
That'll change.
You need a hobby.
And this I see many a morning, what you're seeing right now, boxing up things and pulling the car up next to the door. And
always.
Always.
You
yeah.
see my house.
So do you collect recycled stuff? I mean, do you have a list someplace of what you collect?
No, just if it doesn't.
Well, she doesn't need to anymore.
If it doesn't smell bad, I'll usually take it.
People bring things all. She's got it well. People are well versed. At the end of the school year, they bring her stuff. But all year long, she's getting things. And I know because I'm in another school trying to make that happen. You know, sending out the list and you know, so people get used to the kind of things. And once you're in gear, that people love to help you bring you the recycled stuff.
Colleen, we're still using your white envelopes.
Oh, great.
Really?
Oh, my gosh. We use everything.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Have a good evening.
Thank you.
You got it?
All right. Continuing on, 5.0 reports to the board. 5.1 is the principal's report.
Great.
Anything you want to highlight for us?
No, I think we're making it through SBAC testing for the second year in a row. And almost done, and then NECAP science assessment comes, so my kids are getting their share of assessments. I did want to recognize that Howard Coffin came to visit. That was Paul Rochelot did that, so I hope you can. It was quite a thing for our school to have such a famous person come. And, our kindergarten through fourth grade teachers are working on the summer reading program to really that's a big hole for some kids who don't read during the summer, and so we really are trying to support that and find ways to promote it. Sometimes local libraries do that, and we thought we wanted to try something within school so teachers can be part of that, and it's really exciting for us. And the Puppets in Education are coming. I think I might have mentioned this before. This was a grant that was given to us by Cher Chevrolet. 2 days, they are the old kids on the block, now Puppets in Education, and they're coming to do some of their plays, one on bullying and cultural diversity, making healthy choices as far as eating, and also for second grade autism awareness. So excited.
You call them old kids on the
block. I said old kids on the block?
To some of us, that actually is funny.
I think she said the old new kids on the block.
I think she just said the old kids on the block.
She did say
of course.
It,
to those of us of a certain age.
They used to be called the Kids on the Block. If you know those, but so it's the same type. It's the same puppet. They just have a new name. So, but it's a great organization. Right, and we worked it out so kindergarten through fifth grade students will get at least one, an hour with them watching a couple performances. So I'm excited about that. And that's it. And kindergarten orientation went really well.
How many we got?
I think we're still not quite at 50 yet. So we're still doing great. And we have some other people coming in and we're, you know, running them through the different things we need to. But it was really positive, and I think people appreciated it. It's always fun to see those kids come through the door and get very excited. And
I was in the school that day. It was fun to see them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the parents actually, we've started now having the eighth graders come down and talk to the parents for a part of the presentation that the parents are getting. And it's great because I think they see the eighth graders not as really big kids, but just as kids who still play with Legos and, you know, still have stuffed animals. And, you know, they talk about all the fun things they get to do with the little kids, too. So it's, and they talk about when they were in kindergarten and what they remember. It's just, it's a fun thing. And it's lots of good questions, lots of great accolades about the school from parents. As they, once again, walking through the halls, remarking on all the beautiful artwork and just how wonderful the school looks and the feel of the school. Just being very positive and joyful. So it's always great to show that school off.
Can I ask a question about puppets and change up?
Yeah.
So just curious, you said it was a Shear Chevrolet grant?
Yeah.
So who applied for that?
We didn't.
You didn't?
It was just granted to us.
Dan Bocan does work with community schools, Shelburne.
Right. Who does?
Dan Bocan, he's the general manager there.
Yeah.
The reason why I ask is because we have money sitting in PI unused. We didn't have any spring grant applications.
Really interesting.
And we can sit down. Puppets Education has been on the list for a while as something. Puppets Education and the other one is the circus, Circus Smirkus.
Yep.
As like nice to have. So someday when we have money, we would love to pay to have them come to the school. So this is good to know.
Yeah, this was, and it was nothing we asked for.
Yeah.
It just,
that's great.
Yeah, it's awesome. Wonderful. And Kate, here's a nice email to get.
Now knowing that nobody applied for spring grants. I think we
got one after we said, oh my gosh, no one applied, and we extended the deadline, and we said, no one applied. We got, I think, one.
Let's sit down and talk, because Lyda Winfield came today and is coming tomorrow and is another presenter that is talking about overcoming adversity and differences.
I just got the email from Mr. Garland today. Yeah. I clicked the link and saw the video, and I'm like,
yeah,
holy
she's amazing.
Cow, who is this woman? Yeah. She's going to be great.
But we're paying for that out of our own enrichment fund, so it's something that we can...
It's hard to plan for these kinds of things.
Yep.
Right, and to get somebody like Circus Smirkus, I mean, it might be a good thing to save, because you can then add it to other funds. Are expensive.
That's what our plan is, yes.
Right, they're very expensive. So if what you have is $5,000, that would not be enough.
Right.
Okay. Right, to impact the whole school.
Right.
So.
And what you heard at Common Topic with the bullying and harassment and the need to up the training, it's something that we have to.
Right.
So exactly what.
With the puppets in education.
And Lyda, and I mean, it's it's ongoing, and it's. We may not always be calling it bullying and harassment prevention, but it's just talking about empathy, teaching differences, accepting differences,
being nice.
Yeah, all those all those things, but there may be a little uptick in in bringing people in and guest presenters, because there's only so many times that we can say the policy.
Right.
Yeah.
Different voice.
Speaking of videos, 5.2, I would just point out that Sandy sent around a video yesterday. It's addressed to all school boards, so hopefully everybody got it, to talk about the professional development process. I have not yet had a chance to watch it, so I can't give you any more detail, but it's sort of connected, I would assume, in a way, to the calendar discussion and action item that we're going to talk about.
Keith, that's called Kool-Aid.
Yes. That's the Kool-Aid, apparently.
It is.
That Bill has drank.
Gallons of.
Heavily.
You drank the Kool-Aid?
Well, I made a comment about the calendar. Keith asked me, what Kool-Aid have I been drinking? Because I... I encouraged us to adapt the new calendar so we could train our professionals properly.
No more Kool-Aid for you.
So when you get a chance, you can take a look at that. Now, sort of segueing from that 5.3 CSSU debrief, I would say that the big topic that we did talk about at the SU meeting was on the calendar. We've talked about this both at the SU and at the locals for at least 2 months running. I know it's been a discussion for a long time, and we had a very lengthy and informative discussion and debate at the SU meeting about the new calendar, with essentially for the K-8s a early release on Tuesdays an hour earlier than normal on most, though not all, of the Tuesdays during the course of the school year. The sum and substance of the result of that discussion was that the SU board did take a vote on whether the members of the SU board approved of the new calendar for the 2016-17 school year, with the early release on Tuesdays for K-8s and the late start on Wednesdays for CVU. And that motion approved, I don't know exactly how many people were there, but everybody, all but one, voted in favor. So the administrators asked for that action, for that motion and action, so that they would have a sense of what might happen at the local meetings.
In the point about consistency.
And the reason why the administrators ask for that is in order to have some consistency across the various school districts in our SU, because obviously it would create some amount of chaos if not all, if some but not all, adopted such a calendar and schedule. Yes, Bill?
Just discuss how we amended to make it, please.
Every week the same.
The calendar presented in the packet to the SU, and I assume in the local one as well, had some variation of some Tuesdays with early release and some Tuesdays not with early release. And we had a discussion indicating that inconsistency would cause many problems from a parent's perspective of trying to keep track of these things. So rather than have them sporadic somewhat throughout the year, we urged the administrators to create a schedule whereby the early release will happen essentially from September through May, but in June we will not have the early release, because there is less need for that professional development time at the end of the year as opposed to at the beginning and throughout the year. Anything else from the SU meeting?
We discussed Dave Connery made a presentation discussing Act 46, basically if you were going to run for the... When we vote on Act 46, we also have to vote at the same time on two Hinesburg board members to be members of the new district school board. And Dave outlined how to get a petition, the timeline, to get that submitted so your name could be on the ballot during that time. So
petitions available from town clerk, and they need to be back to the town clerk by May 6th, I believe. So it's a fast turnaround.
But the process is, for those of us that are on the board, the process is the same as what we went through of getting people to sign a petition and submit it. The issue is the timing needs to be acted upon very quickly. And again, from a numbers standpoint, the new proposed board, if there's consolidation, the new proposed board would have two Hinesburg representatives on it.
That's it.
All right. 5.4, parent council debrief. Well, we happen to have one member of it here.
Our
liaison is Stacy as well. Have we met as a board since the family dance?
No.
No, we haven't. So
I had so much fun.
That I will echo that completely.
I have that information. I just have to go back and forth between all the little sources of information I have here. Let's see. Where are you?
Do a family dance.
There you are. So the family dance.
Describe to Shayla what the family dance
is. Yeah, so the family dance is a dance that Pi started last year.
Pi's PTO, essentially.
Yeah, and they raise money to provide grants for different educational things that come up throughout the year that people apply for. So I never really understood Pi even did, but that's what they do. Right? Okay.
Way more than that.
More than that.
Sure, that works.
Teacher appreciation, all kinds of things.
Yeah.
So they had a family dance at the gym. Anybody K, pre-K, 8 could come with their families and silent auction raffles, different ways of raising money. Total fun. Yeah, last year was great. This year was great. This year they raised $3,800.
Last year was around 4, so it was a little bit less.
A little bit less this year. But still a huge success. $3,800 is great. Yeah. And then they recently just finished the Frozen fundraiser, which they raised around $2,000. So with that, which is amazing. Yeah. And as Kate said, there were no spring grant apps. So right now they're going to roll that money, I guess, to next year.
It's been quite a discussion topic about what to do with that.
I'm sure.
Because as soon as we said we didn't have any grant applications, various people were like, well, hold on, I'll think of something. And I'm like, no. Yeah.
Doesn't work that way.
I think rolling it to next year is a good idea. Yeah, we'll just put it in next year's pot.
And upcoming events, seed and sample day, Friday, April 29th. You have a sign up for volunteers for that?
You know, I keep expecting to hear that they need volunteers, and I haven't heard anything. Have you heard anything? I think the two parents that run it have got it under control with the teachers.
Yeah, okay.
Usually so
the kids come in and they plant seeds and they sample different fruits and vegetables, right?
Yeah, and they plant.
And they plant, and right.
Yeah.
So that's really fun. Staff Appreciation Week, May 2nd to May 6th. So Pi is putting together some stuff to show appreciation for the faculty. The All Pi Partner Meeting is Monday, May 2nd. And they're selling tickets right now for the Lake Monsters game, which the orders are due Friday, May 6th. And you're collecting box tops again for your spring rush for those. So that's Monday, May 23rd. Those are due. And then you have on here, so kindly, the school consolidation vote is Tuesday, June 7th.
Yep. One more thing. On Saturday, May 7th, I think these are originally Pi funds at the playground.
So the playground?
Pi was, we were first forming Pi.
Right.
So there weren't really any Pi funds for the playground. And we
I missed
wrote
that.
Grants.
I skipped over that line.
So you wrote grants.
So
right.
So but we've had this from the state of Vermont, actually.
So we had, Pi helped organize it. So
yes.
We've had this playground for our Triple E students, for 3 years since I've been here. And the original place that we wanted to put it was not the appropriate place for it, we found out. And so we found another place for it, and it's getting put in May 7th.
Which we need parent volunteers for.
So where is that going?
In, down near, I don't know, do you still call it the baseball field or the...
The mud pit?
how about the pavilion?
I don't know.
The
people
pavilion.
Like
oriented toward the pavilion.
Right. Yeah. So we don't have to move anything else, and we found Tim was happy because he found out something didn't have to be anchored down with big cement and all this. So.
It's that hoop with where the ball can come out in the four
right.
different ways. It's just that plastic
right.
pole thing, so we can
right.
move that.
Right. We can move that.
Oh, so it's that side of the pavilion. That's what I kept trying to get a sense of.
Yeah.
Is it to the right of the pavilion
no.
or the left? So it's
right.
the left. Where the ball thing is, and I'm going to move the ball
yeah.
thing. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. We got it worked out, and then it'll be great.
Answer. Sorry?
It'll be great.
Yeah.
So
what time is that?
We're looking for volunteers for anywhere between 8 and 1 p.m. on the 7th, because we know it's Green Up Day, and people have plans to do Green Up Day, so you could come before your community Green Up Day. You can come after anytime between 8 and 1. And we don't need that many volunteers. It's
right.
not a gigantic project, but, you know.
Someone and Bob Pettinelli is coming. And
Playground Bob will be there.
Playground Bob, yeah. He's donating his time. to help out with that.
Nice.
Yep.
So to circle back to the seed day, I did find an email that they put an article on the record.
The record, yeah.
We should put something out in the Viking, but they are looking for volunteers. There's a sign-up genius.
They are. For seed and sample day, though, is the one I was expecting, yeah. But I haven't seen. They are looking for people to volunteer to take over being in charge of the garden in general.
Yeah.
There's two parents that have been running it for six years in there.
We need to
help them out.
It's
a lot, right.
Yeah. They've done so much for the garden. And
it's hard because you need to find parents who have availability during the school day, mm-hmm. which is just tough for a lot of parents that I know.
Right.
Regular hours, so it's a challenge.
All right. I told you I was a little out of it. I should have introduced Joanne. You gotta have your moment.
I was gonna.
But I should have at least introduced you, Shayla. I'm sorry for doing that.
I figure out what triple E students are over here.
You can whisper to me all the time you want. You can just whisper.
You're making me feel better already.
What did Dave Connery say to, was it Amanda, at the last CSSU meeting? He said something about it's going to take you a year to figure out what all the acronyms are, and then you won't care anymore. So you're coming, but anyway, Shayla is going to be our new board member. 5.5, facilities committee, that's there as a placeholder, not necessarily because we need to have any
report. Can I circle back to that too? And
yeah.
Did we ever figure out who was going to serve on that committee in Kathy's absence?
I think it was me.
Was it you? Okay, I'd like to set up a meeting. I just didn't know who to.
And just so you know, one of the things that I think we had proposed to talk about at the retreat was the aforementioned baseball field.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's
that
what
might
I wanted
be
to meet
a
about.
Good thing to talk about at the retreat. However, what came another thing that came up at the SU meeting was questioning whether we're going to have a retreat, or at least the timing of it, because the retreat is scheduled 7, 8, 9 or so days before the consolidation vote, and so there's a question of, you know, how valuable is.
Right.
That for all the locals.
Can I offer input on that?
Please.
So even if all of the communities approve consolidation, the current existing boards have to play out the next year. And it seems to me that the retreat drives the next year in some ways.
I don't disagree with that at all. I'm just reporting that came up at the SU. We didn't have any discussion or debate about it, but
yeah.
I think that is a very valid point. All right.
So I wouldn't take it up.
Discussion matters 6.0. 6.1, there are three policies there because Mike has told us we took off 6.1.2. The board package for this meeting includes those policies and a memo from Cindy KW that she always writes summarizing the changes. Anybody have anything they want to talk about of those three policies that are on there?
I do. I was surprised on the weapons policy.
Yeah.
Is that where we are now?
I know. I'm not actually
okay.
Official, but I was too.
Because we had a recent incident with a younger child, and I think that we had talked about, well, that's kind of silly. You get a kindergartner who violates this policy because of whatever, silliness. And we talked about age application of the policy and the, what's the word I'm looking for?
Intent is... So can I?
I know the intent piece. And I get that, but
it was
silly that there needed to be a recommendation to the board for us to vote on a first grader whether or not they should be expelled for a year. There's just silliness. So I think we had talked about modification to the policy when it's clear the intent is not there, and it is sort of determined by the principal. It's all being handled. It's not necessary to bring us in for a vote on something like that. That maybe the wording could have been modified to take that into account, the child's age.
So the policy has been...
Colleen, you are the policy committee rep from this board, correct?
Yeah. So policy committee had a lengthy discussion about
this, and I think it's addressing your concern by changing the policy to be explicit about intent. So that, let's say a kid in high school brings a butter knife to school or a table knife to school to make peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. The old weapons policy would have required a hearing. The new weapons policy does not, because it's about intent.
Okay, so, if the intent is clear, then there is no hearing.
That's correct.
Where was it?
I didn't catch that. I was looking for it.
I think there's also,
I was looking for it.
To be fair, I think there's another side of that coin, which is there are other policies that allow the principal discretion to still discipline a student if he or she believes that discipline is appropriate for, you know, bringing a knife to school, even if the student doesn't wield it in a threatening manner.
But intent is a big one.
With respect to this weapons policy, and what essentially, if I remember correctly, is almost a mandatory expulsion.
Right.
Yes, that has been changed purely to an intent-based policy.
So I looked for it, and I guess I didn't read it right, so that's good.
No, and Stacey, I'm with you, because what I really like about when policies change is the crossing out of words and being able to see former...
It's in the SU packet.
I'm looking at it.
I looked for it, and I didn't see it, but...
The only thing that's changed is the length of the blade.
Yeah, I thought they just changed length of the blade so that the two and a half or whatever it was...
Unless the intent was changed, I don't have the original policy with me.
But it doesn't show where things were.
I don't remember intent... being
there
before.
It's the last one, right? Yeah, there it is.
Because I remember...
So it's in the definition of what... Of 3A1. Any knife, dagger, switchblade, or folding knife, including a pocket knife and pen knife, shall be considered a dangerous or deadly weapon if it is used, threatened to be used, or possessed in a threatening manner, or with the intent to cause harm to any person.
But that's so what's always been in there.
No, what's...
Because there's no red mark through that piece of the intent piece. So why did we have to have a hearing?
I was told by
the
superintendent.
So then,
I don't think
if
that
it
was
is used.
So then you go down to sanctions. Sanctions is where this is what you have to do.
Right. Down
and
here.
That hasn't been changed either.
No.
A1, including pocket knife, blah, 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 shall be considered
a, period there.
A dangerous weapon.
Can you see the period?
It is used.
It's All I'm saying is it hasn't changed.
No, it has changed quite a bit. Okay. In the previous version, there are two sentences. Sentence one says, any knife, dagger, switchblade, or folding knife with a blade in excess of 2 inches, period. That's a weapon.
That's the trigger for the hearing.
Now the definition of a blade has changed to say with the intent.
Exactly.
So you no longer meet the definition of a weapon, therefore you don't even get to the sanctions piece.
Right.
Correct.
If it is used.
I was looking for that, and the way I read it, because I'm a CPA, not an attorney.
I see what you mean.
Staying in my numbers boxes over here.
So just crossing out those two.
Crossing out those
two. All I know is I wanted it to change for that, and I'm glad it did.
Yep.
So that's what I was looking for.
Great. Right. Well, I looked too, and I wondered about that.
Yeah.
Because our hands as administrators have been tied.
The key is we are untying your hands.
Great.
In the situation of, well, the situations we've had in my time on the board.
Two of them.
Three of them.
Two for me.
It's giving you more discretion.
Yeah. Which is great.
So now you have discretion under the weapons policy, but you also have discretion under some other policies.
Right.
If you, notwithstanding the fact that whatever the thing is, if it's not a weapon, you still have other policies that you can use.
Right.
Does that
help?
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay. Thank you,
I just wanted to make sure that was in there.
Thank you, Stacey.
All right. So that was, I think, what we had on 6.1.
I'm testing your red eyeness here.
Yeah.
Sorry.
My red eyeing on red lining. Six, anything else on the policies?
No.
Do we have to approve them or anything?
No. Again, these ones we visit this month for discussion, and then next month these three will show up in the consent agenda as an action item, the same way the ones in 8.3 are in the consent agenda tonight, which were our discussion last month. All right, 6.2 communications boards corner. You know, I think what I have been envisioning is any communication that we do going forward that essentially comes from the board as opposed to the Viking and school stuff, it's going to be the Act 46 stuff. And I know the communications committee is working on things that we can circulate.
Do we also need to talk about June 6th?
Yeah, this so this is the hearing piece, is that what you're referring
us,
to?
We got to talk about that in communications.
So as required by law, we have to have a public hearing on this special meeting within 10 days of the vote, similar to what we would do for our budgets. And so the thought of, you know, last week and up through tonight was to have it Monday, the 6th, and then I realized that it might be conflicting with the select board meeting, and so perhaps we have it earlier than the select board meeting. Or
can I make a comment
I'm
on
confused.
That?
Yeah.
So we have to have an informational session before the vote for Act 46.
Within each community, each town has to have their own.
Colleen, I think we. If it would be possible, if we could convince the selectmen to do it, have the meeting at the school and have them hold their select board meeting at the school after our
or we could go there.
informative session.
So I'm going to the select board Monday, May 2nd. I guess that's next week, isn't it? They have such a full agenda these days. I guess there are some issues that a number of people in the community are concerned about. I don't know if they would be comfortable moving.
Then maybe we have it in the town hall upstairs.
Maybe we have it at town hall.
How long would our meeting take?
Depends on how many people come and how many questions they have.
What time do their meetings normally start?
Are we going to plan a presentation?
7.
Or just be there for Q&A?
I think we have a short presentation, the material for which is already produced, essentially.
Yeah.
So perhaps we have a meeting that is 6 o'clock, and
I would argue to the select board, if they push back, that this one vote could impact the community, dare I say, as much as anything that's going to happen in the next.
Mm-hmm.
Short time in the town. And this is...
Are there not other days to do it?
Well, I'm just saying, it's just a lot of impact. And, you know, this is very important. And I think we need to let them recognize that too, you know?
We're talking about when and where to hold the hearing. And do you know what other communities are doing? They're all having it at their schools?
It's just in Shelburne when they were discussing it, and I think that they're planning on June 6th,
everyone's
pending
Monday.
Talking to the select board and seeing if there's any conflict.
Okay.
The others haven't had that conflict. They're not there yet.
I mean, we could run it by them.
Yeah. Charlotte. Charlotte's doing June 6th.
I would urge you to do more than run it by them.
Right.
I would urge you to advocate.
What do you want?
We should have it on Monday, June 6th.
But where? Question is...
I'm not hung up on geography.
Me neither.
Me neither.
The timing is the important part for me in terms of having it the night before the vote. I would prefer to not have it at 6. I would have it later. So if there's any give and take that the select board might have, if we could have 7 to 8...
When does the select board meeting schedule?
Yeah, their agendas are so full. I don't see giving them.
We're asking for an hour on one night.
For a critical
never
vote.
Never again.
For a critical vote.
They have moved their meeting earlier before when they've been pressured. Their meeting starts at 7, but they've moved it to 6 before.
I'll talk to someone tomorrow.
Yeah. I can call Tom. He's a friend of mine.
Oh, I've got a. I'm already on the agenda for next Monday,
perfect.
So
you're good.
They have their administrator set up meetings.
Okay.
Let me just. Sorry, I know we got to drop. We got to move, but I think we, as Keith said, we need to advocate for a position to have our voices heard, and we need to help the select board recognize how important this is. This isn't something that we're asking for as, well, it would be nice, like, this is really, really important to the community. So that's all I would say.
And,
pardon me?
What are the alternatives?
Right?
Right. We hold the meeting on our own at 7 o'clock on Monday, June 6th.
Right.
You know, if we can get their cooperation, great. I would like it. But if we don't, maybe we hold the meeting anyway.
Do they typically have a lot of audience members?
There are a number of issues going on in town right now, and their agendas are very full, and they may meet for a very long time.
That's an understatement.
All right, then.
Keith, is that something...
My life is full enough without that.
No, I don't think so.
I just want to make sure it's in my calendar if I need to have it in my calendar.
No.
Okay.
It's us.
Yeah.
Great.
I would say that one concern that I've heard from people in the community and just to think about is our school board has been very attentive to, and administrators have been very attentive to facilities. And so what you might hear in Hinesburg is why should Hinesburg be paying for others' facilities? And I think one of the things we need to remind people is that, you know, our time will come. You know, Shelburne just had their bond passed. Williston is likely to go forward with a bond, $12 million bond. And it's only a matter of time before it's Hinesburg's turn again.
Before we get our new gym and theater and...
What'd you call
their
it?
Their facilities policies, but...
Baseball field.
Cafe Gymatorium.
Cafe Gymatorium.
Great. No, in all seriousness,
Still have some debt payment, right, for the primary wing.
Well, and if Act 46 goes through, right, all the schools belong to everyone, and
they're sharing your resources. Our time will come with future financings, but everyone pays the bill for our existing financings.
Right. And for every town in the school district, everyone stands to gain. So,
all right.
Educationally and
moving on. So I added two things. It's my fault that we're going to take this time. But 6.3, staff appreciation. The board is going to sponsor something on Friday, May 6th. Is that the right date?
Yes.
Yeah, because
Friday, May 6th.
Saturday.
Okay. So I wanted to make sure the board was aware of that and then have a short discussion about what it's going to be and what you need from us.
Well, Allie was the point person for that.
Yep. And she and I have scheduled it. That was the day that worked around the whole week of activities. Should you and I talk about this offline?
Yeah, I think so. But she shared...
What would be an appropriate time for any board member who's available to come? 7:30, 8?
Yeah, if you're able to be there at 7:30,
okay.
And then we'll figure out the what. But if you're able to be there at 7:30, that'll give teachers a good 20 minutes before they have to be in their classrooms to come and check in. And other people will be available as, depending on their morning schedule.
You and I can talk about it a little bit offline in terms of
the what.
More the what.
Yeah.
But I just want to make sure that it was on people's calendars.
Yep.
All right.
And if you have ideas, send them to Keith. I know that Allie and I talked briefly. She has a doc of the other things that are happening the previous 4 days.
Yep. That would be
and I haven't
guidance.
That hasn't been shared with me yet. So
okay. All right. 6.4 Peck Estate. I'm going to bring this up tomorrow night, Colleen, at our Act 46 committee meeting.
Okay.
But I was thinking about this, and I got an email last week from the Peck Estate trustees. That we benefit from money from the Peck Estate, and under the trust document, it's meant for Hinesburg students. So that when it goes into the kitty, if there's consolidation, we're going to have to make sure that the intent of that estate is honored. Mm-hmm. I assume there are other funds right. like this mm-hmm. in CSSU. I know there are in uh-huh. other That's SUs around the state considering consolidation because I've been asked this question right. several times. So my legal advice in that situation was we got to honor the intent of the estate. So we got to look at the trust documents. Now, if the trust documents in Hinesburg, in the Peck Estate situation, are very clear, I don't think we need to do anything. Mm-hmm. But if they're not clear, then we may be asked to do something to make right. sure that's continued to be honored by the new board.
Mm-hmm. And, I mean, that connects with issues related to fundraising, which, you know, the FAP, PI may be interested in. Williston has the FAP. So fundraising recommendations to a newly consolidated board would be to continue to honor these local fundraising efforts that support local culture issues and so forth. If it, you know, if it were to get to a point where the numbers are just so dramatic that it creates incredible inequity among the supervisory union or supervisory district, then it would be an issue. But I think, you know, every local parent-teacher organization has had this question. Mm-hmm. But that's the recommendation that's going to come out of the committee.
Okay. All right.
And it seems to me the Peck Estate would fall into that category.
Okay. All right. Here we go. You ready? 7.0. Action matters. 7.1. Appoint new board member. So I am pleased to reintroduce and welcome Shayla Livingston to our board meeting. She has graciously volunteered to fill our fifth board seat. Bill was kind enough to suggest her. I assume it was with consent.
That's questionable, but she owed me.
But I guess why don't we hear a little bit from you if you'd like to give us a little bit of background, and then I would entertain a motion to appoint her to the board.
Sure. So, well, thanks for having me. And I live in Hinesburg. I moved here fairly recently, about 2 years ago. Yeah, right. There are some basic requirements. My boss was like, "Oh, yeah, I tried to do that, and I'm Canadian, and turns out I can't." And I said, "Right, maybe I should just look that up." And make sure. So funny. I work at the health department. I'm an analyst, an epidemiologist, an alcohol and drug abuse programs for the state, and I'm from Vermont. I'm from Sharon, Vermont. So I grew up here. And yeah, I've known Bill for a while now, before I moved to Hinesburg.
I know your name. From the YRBS.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. So I went.
As soon as you said it, I was like, yeah.
Yep, right. Yeah. Oh, I hope I didn't like hassle you too much.
Oh, God, no.
There's another acronym, yeah. But I just okay. Let it go so by.
For multiple years, I ran the Youth Risk Behavior Survey, which is the school, middle, and high school survey for all students in Vermont about all sorts of different fun risk behaviors. Last year was especially exciting because we added some sexual activity questions to the middle school survey. So we
I remember that.
I think every school board in Vermont remembers that.
That was fun. That was exciting. I don't know. I don't know if I'm going to vote her in. I don't know.
Had I known, I wouldn't have.
Where were you?
Public health, people. Public health. 5% of middle school students have oral sex, just so we all know. It's a thing that happens.
What was the percentage?
It's public record. No, right?
5%.
Goes up for 8th graders. Yeah, it's a problem. Anyway. That aside, school health and
this is recorded, you know. This is recorded.
I've done many presentations. You don't want me to do. You want me to do a presentation on?
No, we're good. We're good.
I could see him get added to the common topic.
Exactly.
Statistics about our youth.
Yeah. Worked on healthcare reform there, and that's how I got involved in public health. Was doing the Affordable Care Act.
Just before I met you, you received your master's, right?
Yep. Yep, and yeah, that experience drove me to think that maybe we had a little work to do, so I got my master's in public health in California, UC Berkeley. Yeah.
And
So I knew her, and I thought that, you know, she's in your, and also you tell them what your dad does.
Oh, and my father has been, he was an elementary school teacher for 25 years. His favorite grade is second grade because they were old enough to put on their own snow clothes, but not old enough to talk back yet. And now he is a high school principal. And he's the principal of the Sharon Academy in Sharon, Vermont. So needless to say, we get into lots of really interesting Act 46 school funding. Yeah, conversations, but he's, yeah, so I've
so I thought about that. So when I met, I just thought, I don't know, Annette and her, also you should know her partner, fiance, right? Mm. He's a scribe for 7 days, political scribe, so, you know.
Boy, watch what you say.
Exactly, so, you know, I'm off the record, but no, they're both smart, engaged people, care about Vermont, and I thought, given Shayla's public health background, and frankly, you know, new to town, but, you know, excited to be engaged, that she'd be a good candidate, so I kind of harassed her via text for a while, and listen to that, and... So I was glad to hear that she was happy to come help us out. So I would make a motion to appoint Shayla Livingston to the Hinesburg Community School Board.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Stacy, for that second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Welcome to the board. Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
We're a fun board. Just ask them.
Now I can start asking questions, right?
Yeah.
You can ask questions
anytime.
And
then we can start asking you questions,
yeah. Yeah. That's
right.
I'm okay with that.
All right, well, the next one's easy. The one after that, I can't. Mm. I make no promises. 7.2, 2015-16, calendar last student day, faculty day. Last student day administration recommendation is Friday, June 10. K-8 faculty is Friday, June 15. Can I have a motion for
you
that?
You said Friday, June 15, Wednesday, June
15. Wednesday, June 15. Sorry, see, there's my math off.
Hold on. So what's the last student day?
Friday, June 10. That's next year's calendar.
This is for this year.
Okay. We're still on this year.
Thank you.
Motion?
I need a motion.
I motion to approve the recommendation.
Thank you, Colleen. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Stacy. Any discussion? The key question that always comes up
is cutting a day, right?
What days are we cutting?
Monday, right?
It's going to come up.
Monday, right?
First students.
Yeah.
I'm looking teachers. At the wrong calendar, so I don't know anymore.
That'd be an extra day for teachers. An extra in-service day for teachers.
Yeah, the teachers would come.
The teachers
that would be
contract.
One of their days. Yep. Yep. But the student day that we're cutting is a Monday in June.
Correct.
And last year,
all
when we had
itself.
The same issue, was it the same fact pattern?
We had a similar issue. It was not the same fact pattern. I think we were asked to cut Monday and Tuesday, or Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, something like that.
Well, I think it was three.
It was two.
It was not just the Monday.
It's a good use of teacher time.
And we're still statutorily compliant with 175.
Right.
And that takes into account snow days, right? Yeah.
Right.
I'm good.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Motion. Motion carries. 7.3, adopt 2016-17 CSSU calendar. This is, of course, the issue that we talked about at the SU meeting that we covered in the debrief so many minutes ago under 5.3 of the agenda on our meeting. So I guess I'd like a motion first, and then once that's out there, we can have some further discussion. Can I have a motion to adopt that calendar?
So, with an amendment to the motion,
As with amended in the materials as we discussed in the CSSU debrief with respect to stacking them all at the beginning of the year and not in
consecutively.
June.
Same schedule every week.
Every week except for the very end of the year.
Oh, so moved.
Thank you, Bill. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Colleen. Any discussion?
please.
I have some discussion. I apologize, Board. I was not here at the last meeting or the meeting before. One, because I'm dumb, and two, because I was busy. So, being dumb and busy, I missed those two.
You're not dumb.
Well, I was dumb that one time, so.
And we're all busy, so.
No, I'm definitely busy, but the second time was dumb. So, I was going to be here at 7, but you guys were done. I've talked with a number of people about this. I understand it may already be a done deal or whatever, but I appreciate the positive benefits of going to this type of schedule, but I think there are significant effects, negative effects to different people, different populations of people within the community. And I'm just going to share the feedback I've collected at this point. In fact, I ended up collecting some additional feedback on other things, which I thought was interesting in doing this, but one thing, and this may have all been vetted, so I'm just going to throw out what I heard. So one thing that was mentioned to me was sports and teachers who coach and the impact there. Or just in general sports and kids getting out early and just trying to coordinate schedules with games that night and whatnot. I don't know if that's a non-issue. You said it was a non-issue, sports, but I don't.
No games on Tuesdays.
Or practice.
So there just would be
that's why it's on Tuesday.
And it was already sort of an issue because faculty meetings are on Tuesday, so games would have had to be much later anyway.
Oh, okay.
So that's why this is on Tuesday, because it can piggyback off of that.
Okay. I got some feedback from Lorianne, part two. And she is very concerned about it being on Tuesday, and I understand why Tuesday was chosen now, but apparently Tuesday is the highest enrollment day for the whole week for the after school program, and she has to staff off of Tuesday, and that means that she's going to have a higher staff level now to accommodate just Tuesday, where she won't need that level of staffing the rest of the week. And I think there's just general concern in that, how is the community going to fill the void to take care of these kids, especially for, say, low-income families who try to make things work as it is to get out of work in time or cover for each other. I know a number of families that just it's hard for them to make ends meet and to take care of their kids and pay for after-school care. And I think this is going to be a hardship for a number of families.
I can address the Imagine piece.
Sure.
So the Imagine piece is a non-issue. What Lorraine is referring to is that Tuesday is the highest enrolled days, but I've already assured the board and Elaine that we'll be able to accommodate whatever students need that care.
And so you're not worried about space?
No, because
for the
after school
program?
Because in conjunction with what we just talked about, there's not any extracurricular activities, the sports. So the gym will be available, the classrooms will be available, the flex, like all the spaces will be available in the school.
And enrollment in Imagine is limited, right? So what are families going to do that only need care on Tuesday and can't get into Imagine?
So it's not. I think what you're talking about is that it's limited by our license, and our license is 135 kids.
Okay.
And on Tuesday it's about 65 right now, so we would have to more than double. So, in terms of parents that need Imagine, we'll be able to make that work.
Okay. I just saw the email from Janine saying people that are currently in Imagine will have first dibs, but we may get full and you may not be able to get in if you don't get your name on the list. So I was just going off of that.
I have not seen that communication, but it's not accurate.
Okay. All right.
And I'm saying, I'm sure the communication is out there. I just need to talk with Janine to clear that up.
Well, it sounds like there is a capacity, but you're very confident that it's not going to get hit.
And if it does, there's there's other ways. Imagine now also does the enrichment portion of the school activities, and those
that enrichment portion doesn't get counted against our regulations. So even if we have to come up with,
you can come up with creative ways to provide enrichment.
Yep, the kids at Hinesburg are going to be taken care of if parents need that.
And is there something that we can do for low-income families to provide this extra care on Tuesdays to make sure that they're not sort of, you know?
Yep.
Getting the low end of the stick?
Absolutely. And I always have to be aware of my role. And we've heard from other local daycare providers that are also willing to be flexible. So I want to put that out there too. There's other places that kids go after school in our community, and they're willing to be flexible as well.
Yeah,
so I think there's other options other than just Imagine.
No, I understand. But I think what I heard was, there will be a number of families that will need care on Tuesday only.
Mm-hmm.
And because they can't they just can't get home by 2 o'clock or whatever time it ends up being. And so there will be a number of families that only need care on Tuesday. And so you're going to have these after school programs like Annette's or Imagine or whatever, and they're going to have to staff additional staff on that one day and then not need them the rest of the week. And I think it's going to be a challenge to find to manage that, I guess. Yeah. I haven't spoken with Andrea at Annette's directly, but Lorraine had indicated that she didn't think that she was super excited about this because it is going to be difficult to manage.
Stacy, do you think that would be different if it was Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday?
I think Friday would be completely different because I think there...
Friday's not doable, frankly.
Why?
Well, it's the end of the week. You know.
Have you ever held a meeting on Friday afternoon?
I have. I work many hours, many weeks.
Yep.
Most
I work till 10 o'clock some Friday nights.
No,
I get it.
Yeah,
I'm just saying, because Tuesday is the highest enrollment day, I think that poses a volume challenge, where a Friday afternoon may not pose as much of a volume challenge from what I've been told. I'm just sharing what I've got.
You know what? What? Appreciate what you said. What Elaine and we talked about in that CSSU meeting was, sounds like to me, again, I'm not as diplomatic as I should be sometimes, that Tuesday's kind of the day we got to go with this year if we're going to do it. But it doesn't mean it's Tuesday's the day from here till 2025.
Right. I think, the next note on my list was sort of the coordination with the CBU schedule. You know, that's another nightmare for parents that have kids in both places.
Yeah.
So now you're saying, okay, well, this one's going to go in late this day, and this one's going to come home early the next day, and then you're hitting them on both of those times. And I just think it's a shame that we couldn't figure out a way to at least do it on one time for both schools. I watched the video, and I heard everybody speak, but I still can't, because I'm a CPA and I'm not an educator, I can't wrap my brain around why this is so wonderful and why this is such a huge benefit.
What I heard Bill say at the CSSU meeting, which unfortunately, because I like sports a lot, was really the thing that hit it to me, is, you know, when you play basketball, you practice every day. You don't not practice for 4 weeks and then have an 8-hour practice day. In order to keep up your craft, you've got to do a little bit every day, or at least periodically and more frequently than once every 6 or 8 weeks.
As I said in the meetings, you know, I completely, every one of those concerns, I hear you loud and clear, and I agree with them. But what I've come to recognize is, and you know, you're on the board for a while, you learn stuff, and you know, we're all learning as we go here, is I hope, and our administrators do, have very high expectations of our staff to deliver the content to our students in the best way for them to learn. We spend a lot of money on staff salaries, on professional development, and I just really believe from my own experiences and listening to the teachers and being around that, having a professional development
two in August and two in July, you know, I come to think, I think we're throwing good money after bad doing that, honestly. I mean, you know, someone's there, they have a headache that day, whatever, and delivering it in a more consistent basis on a weekly basis is really the best way to deliver any kind of learning to anybody.
Well, and, you know, adults are no different than kids. We ask kids and the faculty that work with them to work with them on a continuous basis with formative feedback and ability to adjust program, ability to adjust the way that they're learning or what they're learning or what they're producing. And it's no different for the adults in our buildings. And what we hear from our administrators is that they're at a stage in the professional development models that we use that they can really benefit from continuous, ongoing, weekly check-ins and production with whatever it is that they're working on. So,
can I just follow up on Stacey's question though? Why couldn't you, especially for families with like multiple kids, why couldn't you do same day,
like Wednesday morning,
or just Tuesday, whatever?
I think the best answer is the practical answer, and that's this: the K-8s have faculty meetings after school on Tuesdays, so that works best for them. I can't remember when the CVU faculty meeting is, but the reason the Wednesday was chosen for CVU is because they have alternating days, red and white, I think they're called. Basically, you go to some classes on red days and some classes on white days, and the Wednesday is, because there's 5 days, the Wednesday is the odd day, and it probably alternates every week or something. And so they figured, okay, rather than disrupt the whole red-white thing, we'll just put it on the day that already switches. And then as between giving high schoolers an extra hour of sleep or letting them out early, because of the science showing the sleep aspects of teenagers needing the later sleep, that chose the morning for that.
But then why couldn't we just move the faculty meeting?
I was just going to say that.
Yeah, so it was discussed. There's pros and cons, and I wasn't in depth with how the decision. It was chosen as Tuesday. Wednesday was chosen for the reasons why Colleen. There was a brief discussion about, can we have it on the same day? And then the flip side of that is that if a parent has a kid in high school and they have to get to school late on Wednesday and then they need to pick up their kid early on Wednesday, that creates a whole different issue. So there's not...
But why can't you do it at the same
time?
So, well, there's no perfect solution for everybody.
Right.
Sometimes decisions are just, it's not going to please all the people all the time.
So on Wednesdays, we're going to have two bus runs on Wednesdays, is that right?
Correct.
Yeah. So research says that high school
and
kids would do
Tuesday
well
afternoon.
If they started school at 9 o'clock every day.
Yeah.
And to get one of those, so it's a positive impact for the students, it's a positive impact for the teachers, and especially at the high school level, then all of a sudden, I don't know, I look at it in both positives, where the parents may not need to be home to make sure that the kid gets to school. You know, so I mean, if there's no parent impact, it's positive on both ends.
I think on that point, that was another reason why there's a distinction between the K-8s and the high schoolers, because there's a little bit more, there's a higher belief that a parent can leave a high schooler alone for 45 minutes or so before the bus comes on that Wednesday morning. Whereas you don't want a K-8 getting off the bus, being home alone, unattended for that hour in the afternoon. And there are structures that we've just talked about that can be implemented to cover those kids if they need it.
Right, so the high school kids can help babysit younger siblings, for example, on Tuesdays, if a family has that kind of a structure.
Well, they're in school, so they can't.
So I mean, everything was thought about, and as Colleen said, whatever big decision is made, you're never gonna make everybody happy. But we feel like we have what I heard, Stacey, a lot of your concerns are the kids, and that's where it should be. Mm-hmm. And what I feel very confident is that Hinesburg Community School and its community partners can make sure that the parents have what they need. And I would like parents to be able to call me, to email me, if they have concerns about the after-school care, that we can make it work for the low income, and I'll work with the community partners, I'll work with our own programs. We're looking at having the library stay open for an extended time at Hinesburg, much like we do on any other day, and figuring out how to staff that. So if the parents really only need that one extra hour, we can figure that out too. We're talking about the late bus running at 3 instead of at 4 for kids that need that, just that one extra hour. I have a meeting on Friday with a parent who would like to discuss options to do with kids. In other school districts around, parent volunteers come in to do things like Four Winds and enrichment activities that are in gratis. And so I'm gonna sit down and listen. But there's gonna be a lot of possibilities, and if I could relieve that anxiety, that worry about the kids, and then you look at the impact for the teachers, it's gonna, like, the impact on the teachers, I don't think we can argue. If I can reduce that anxiety of making sure that the kids have what they need after school and the parents have what they need after school, then I think that it's a no-brainer. But
I just think that there needs to be clear communication to the families about what their options are if this calendar is adopted, because I think a lot of people may not know, oh, hey, I can just voice my concern and ask. They might just grumble and complain, oh, now the calendar's changed and I'm screwed on Tuesdays and la, 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 instead of knowing that there's options for them.
They got to ask days off at work, hours at work, and all that.
Right. Got it.
The positive is that it highlights an issue in our community for every day after school.
I mean, oh, yeah.
So many
It's already an issue.
We need more activities for kids between 3 and 5 o'clock. A lot of kids do need a safe place to spend time.
I think there's a lot of options, but it's just a matter of that one day a week now. We just need to make sure that there are options. I'm more concerned about the low-income families and their ability to make it work.
This just reminds me that at one point we did have an early release that happened on a regular basis on Wednesdays, and kids used to get out at noon. So we used to have half days on Wednesdays for years, mm-hmm. and got away from that. So when I heard the 1 hour early release, I thought, wow, that's a good solution to having a regular meeting. So, obviously we need to find ways to help families and their kids, but 1 hour, it seems reasonable. It's hard to do some of the professional development with kids actually in the room.
Oh, I get the pros of it. I just felt like the cons outweighed it. But if I'm hearing Jeff right, he's reassuring me that there's going to be options. So.
Not only reassuring you, but I'm looking at the positive possibilities that come with having the kids possibly for an extra hour. Imagine we can't do field trips because of the length of time it takes to go somewhere
now
and come back.
Possibly.
Now we can do field trips, now we can do larger projects, things that take more time, and I'm sure other partners are thinking the same thing. And so I'm looking at it as a positive for the kids, and same that Colleen said is that we have to do a better job giving kids more opportunities. Mm-hmm. And this is a way to do that. And making sure that they're accessible and accessible to all students.
Mm-hmm. In soliciting my feedback, some other feedback that I got that's related to the calendar that we can talk about next meeting, hopefully, because I don't think it directly impact. If it does directly impact the calendar, then we should maybe talk about it now. But I've heard a lot of parent concern around free time, recess time, and lunch time. I know my daughter inhales her food every night at dinner, and I have to tell her to slow down and drink water. And I just think it's, my eyes were really open to it for me personally when we had the bring your parent to lunch day. I was like, holy cow, I cannot believe how quickly these kids come in, get their lunch, they woof their food down, and then they're hurrying up to you know, get snow pants on or even eating lunch in their snow pants and then running outside. And I don't think it's healthy that our kids are, we're training our kids to eat that way. I just don't think it's healthy. And I totally get the space issue and the scheduling issue, but I just wish there was a way that we could fix it. And I don't have the solution, but I'm hearing from other parents the same exact thing, and I was already feeling that way. And I don't know if that affects the calendar or the length of the school day or what, but I just wish that there was a way that we could build that time in to fix that or figure out a more creative use of our space to fix that. Because it's just, I don't know, I just think it's really unhealthy the way our kids are doing that right now. And I think they could use more free time.
Can we treat that kind of like the old director's comment that we had? And we've heard it. We've all heard it. Jeff has heard it. And, you know, we'll figure out when and how to discuss it.
Absolutely.
Anything else on the calendar? Are you ready for the question?
Sure. Okay.
So the motion on the table is to adopt the 2016-17 calendar that's in the packet, modified by the grouping of having them all consistent from September through May, but no early release in June, and that's rough. There might be 5 weeks at the end of the year, I can't remember. But the idea is to keep them consistent in very large blocks, not...
Consecutive, inconsistent.
And consecutive, inconsistent. So, all those in favor of that motion, say aye.
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 Any opposed? The motion carries. Thank you very much.
I do wish it was consistent throughout the whole year, though. I don't love that. That's going to be confusing.
We need to make up 3 hours.
We need to make up 3 hours. I think that's what it is.
The calendar.
In order to keep.
You have so many student-teacher contact hours. We need the hours.
Half day and last day.
7.4.
That's easy.
Personnel. Sandy sent us in the materials some information on two potential new hires. 7.4.1 is a new sixth grade teacher. Again, we're not supposed to talk about certain individual characteristics, I believe. So if people want to do that, I would suggest we move this to executive session. But if you have questions about, I guess, the process or the need for this position, we can do that now. Whether you have that or not, we could certainly, I would entertain a motion to approve this hiring of the sixth grade position in 7.4.1.
So moved.
Thank you, Colleen. Second. Thank you, Stacy. All those in, are you ready for the question?
I was going to vote to move to executive session.
Do you want to?
I would.
Okay. All right. Do you feel the same way about 7.4.2?
Yes.
Okay, all right. People okay with that?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
All right.
We have an executive session.
We are.
Okay.
All right, 8.0 then, consent agenda. I would entertain a motion to approve those items.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Stacy. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. The motion carries. 9.0, next meeting dates. May 3rd, we are going to have a special meeting related to setting the date for the Act 46 consolidation vote. This is going to be 5 minutes.
This was the phone call thing.
This is the phone call thing. So Colleen and I are going to physically be there. I think I saw that you're going to be available for a phone call.
Yep.
You two are certainly...
Phone.
Allow. I don't know if they checked with you guys, but if you can be on that phone call, that would be wonderful. Could you...
What time was that at again? Was it 7:30
or 8? It's at 8
a.m.
It's at 8 a.m. And I know I have a bunch of emails from Sandy about how to orchestrate it. I can't remember. Did you give her a number? Do I have a number?
I didn't get any
call?
Number. I just said I could call in.
Okay. Can you? Do you have an email?
Yeah.
With call-in information?
No.
So Keith,
I'm just saying. I told her I could call.
I talked about today.
Yeah.
Logistically.
Yeah.
If your phone is capable to do conference calls,
yep.
You would initiate all the calls you know, call somebody, add a third, second one, a third one.
Oh, I did get call-in information.
You do have call-in information.
What did she say? If you're on this list, please be advised, please be available listed number. I'm going
to
be called.
I'm supposed to call you. Yeah. Does someone know how to do conference calls on this?
Did you have an iPhone?
I can
send you instructions.
Okay. Can you guys email me a phone number at which you will be reachable at 8 a.m. on Tuesday?
How many numbers can you add on the iPhone?
You can just keep it up to five.
You can have five plus one, six people.
Six.
So he can invite five other people, plus himself is six.
That's what I was wondering. Figured there's a limit.
So if you guys want to be on that call, just send me a number where I can reach
you. I just texted you my phone number.
Okay. I probably have it.
But...
All right, May 17 is our next regular board meeting. May 26 is the annual retreat. Keep that on your calendar for now. And then the other two are SU meetings on the 17th and 26th, respectively.
We have to go into the school, too, and sign something. Did you want to cover that?
Yes, thank you.
Do you need it? Or you know?
So... Is that later in the day on Tuesday?
You will need to stop into your school's main office to sign the warnings on Tuesday, May 3rd. Your signature will be necessary in two spots on these warnings.
So Sandy
is
going...
It's crucial in order for me to get the town clerk's signatures Wednesday and get the warnings posted properly by the deadline.
The request is that you go in on that Tuesday. So Sandy is going to physically go from the 8 a.m. 5-minute meetings, take the documents from each of the school districts and go to each of the schools and lead the document for Hinesburg in the Hinesburg's principal's office so that you can stop by and sign it. Like if you could be at CVU, that would save.
Is that the meeting? Is that CVU on?
Yeah. All it is to warn.
But that
June 7th vote, it's like, you know, and you can't vote no, so there's no discussion.
Well, I might be able to be here.
So that meeting at 8 o'clock on Tuesday the 3rd is here?
Here at CVU.
In this room?
In the conference room over by
the main office there.
The main office.
Yeah.
She's going to, Mike is probably aware of this, they're going to distribute us into like five different rooms. You know, someone in principal's office, someone in someone else's office. It's really a 5-minute meeting, and we...
Wait, this is a May 3rd one?
May 3rd.
And what is this for again, F46?
To approve, to set the June 7th as the date for the vote.
Oh, okay.
That's all it is.
But then we got to sign the warnings, too.
And then you got to sign them. Then you got to sign a piece of paper. So if you're physically here, you can do both at the same time. If you can't physically be here, we'll take you on the phone, but then you got to stop by the school later that day.
Okay.
So for those of us in Hinesburg, it's almost easier just to come.
And we all get assigned the warning.
Yeah. Three of us have to.
Oh.
Quorum.
Okay.
It would be nice if everybody was
assigned.
Maybe Charlotte will be early that day.
Bring her.
What?
I'm in Atlanta.
No, she'll be late.
Yeah. So we can sign it. Don't sweat it. We can sign it. So that's.
And you just make sure you get sworn in if you haven't.
Oh yeah, you should get sworn in.
Okay.
So you need to go see Missy Ross. And take some sort of oath.
In the town clerk's office. Yeah.
Yep. Okay. I'll do that.
All right. We all set for that? All right. Then we'll go into executive session upon a motion from...
Me. I move.
Thank you, Stacy.
For personnel.
For personnel, yes.